Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on this very special on-the-road edition episode of the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Have you ever seen a dog that's a spitting image of its owner? The resemblance can be hilariously uncanny, but beyond similarities in affectation, gait, and overall goofiness, we find time and time again that the health of our pets is often reflective of the health of their caretakers. Having dogs or pets around has been an integral part of the human experience for ages. But do you know what the biologically appropriate diet really is for your furry friend? If you've been following fatburningman.com for a while, you may have come across a post or two about my dog Bailey, the Labrador Retriever, who miraculously has survived many near-death experiences, including falling off a small cliff, but, you know, landing into a bush and being okay. But it was a good 20 or 30 feet up. Incredible that she survived. Also, she was hit by a car. She survived several mild to major poisonings of various kinds. But like a cat, she continues to survive. And one of the reasons I think that she does, my wife and I agree, we attribute it to the way that she's been fed over the years, an extremely nutrient-dense diet. And today's guest of the show was actually very influential in the way that we started feeding Bailey the dog all the way back then. So I hope it's very helpful to you as well. And if you're looking for a dog that, or a pet in general, a cat, it doesn't really matter what animal we're talking about, or humans too. You have to look at the diet if you want longevity, quality of life, and overall health and happiness. And so that's what we're talking about today, not just feeding your pets in a biologically appropriate way, but hopefully translating that a bit to what it looks like to feed humans a biologically appropriate diet. So if you want your family and your furry friends to live a long time and to live well, listen to today's show. We're here with Dr. Ian Billinghurst, who's a veterinary surgeon with over 40 years of experience. He's also a nutritionist, acupuncturist, agricultural scientist, lecturer, nutritional consultant, raw pet food producer, and author of multiple excellent books, including The BARF Diet, The Barf Diet for Dogs. As you'll hear in today's show, Dr. Billinghurst was kind enough to send us a generous sample of his fermented, probiotic-rich blend of organic veggies, herbs, cheeses, and pet-friendly superfoods called Gussie's Gut. Our dog Bailey absolutely loves it so far. So hang around, because toward the end of this interview, Dr. Billinghurst will share how you can get a sample for free as well. Now, before we get to the interview with Dr. Billinghurst, here's a quick plug for a family company over at Wild Superfoods. Every purchase that you folks make over at Wild Superfoods directly supports our work on this show, podcasting, video shows, virtual reality, music, and beyond. So we really appreciate it. Right now, it's only in the United States, but if you are in the States and you're looking for a super high quality protein powder, greens powder, omega supplement, D supplement, or much, much more, please visit us over at wildsuperfoods.com. Right now, here's a quick review that came in from Brittany for collagen cocoa, which is one of our daily favorites. She says, "My husband and I love collagen cocoa as our protein powder of choice. Great with water for a post-workout or added into my coffee with heavy cream. It arrived quickly and we are on the subscribe and save plan." Brittany, thank you so much for dropping that review over at wildsuperfoods.com. You can't get this on Amazon or any store or any other website. Every purchase, like I said, directly supports us. So please visit us over at wildsuperfoods.com. If you're looking to save a few bucks, then definitely look at the discounts that you get with the subscribe and save plans as well as the bundles. And if you're looking for a quick discount and it's your first time over at Wild Superfoods, then please use the code WILD15. That's WILD15. And if you're interested in collagen cocoa in particular, it makes a terrific cold or hot drink. And you can't really necessarily tell from the website or me holding it in my hand right now, but this is 1.8 pounds of concentrated protein bone broth goodness, and you get 21 grams of protein per serving. So once more, if you'd like to save a few bucks, please check out the subscribe and save options over at Wild Superfoods. And we really appreciate every little review that you make, every little touch point that you have with us. And I really appreciate whether you ever purchase anything from us or not. I appreciate that you're listening to this show and hope you enjoy the interviews and many shows to come. All right. On to the show with Dr. Ian Billinghurst. We're chatting about the things doctors and veterinarians are paid not to know, what a biologically appropriate diet for our pets really looks like, why you should give your dog a bone, strange similarities between human health and the health of our pets, how to avoid cancer in dogs and cats, and tons more. And I hoped I would get through this whole podcast interview without hearing jets going over us, but we're actually recording this, like I said, from the road next to the Bell helicopter and aircraft plant in Amarillo. So it's actually a remarkable place to watch ridiculous military aircraft, fighter jets, giant planes and jets, helicopters, ospreys, and much, much more have been going on and off all day. So thankfully, we recorded this actual interview ahead of time before we got to the helicopter plant. So that should be smooth sailing from here on out. So with that said, let's go hang out with Dr. Billinghurst. Welcome back, folks. Today, I'm honored to be here with Dr. Ian Billinghurst, a veterinary surgeon with over 40 years of experience, a nutritionist, acupuncturist, agricultural scientist, lecturer, nutritional consultant, raw pet food producer, and author of multiple best-selling books. Dr. Billinghurst is recognized as the father of raw and the founder of the BARF, or biologically appropriate raw food diet. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Billinghurst.
Well, thank you, Abel, for having me. It's a great honor, and it'll be great talking with you this morning. I know, because I've watched your podcasts, and they're fantastic.
Oh, cheers. Thank you for that. Well, we have been a huge fan of your work for many years now. You've been out there for a long time, and it's really your approach to nutrition and diet, not just for our furry friends, pets, cats and dogs, but also for humans. It's really revolutionized the way that we think about food in so many ways. So thank you for doing the work that you do. It's influenced the way that we've fed our dog for more than a decade now. And I would love for you to just give people a brief background as to the actual approach of what a biologically appropriate diet looks like.
Well, very briefly and very simply, it's what an animal would eat in the wild. It's actually the ancestral diet of our dogs. And we also have to remember that that ancestral diet includes the foods that have been eaten right up until the present time. So that's all part of the genomic, genetic, evolutionary background of our dogs. However, there's been a lot of periods during which some of the more recent periods, for example, over the last 100 years, where we've been feeding processed pet food, and it hasn't even been 100 years for many dogs in Australia. It's probably been about 40, 60 years tops, longer in North America, and even fewer years or decades within places like Southeast Asia. So we discount those to a large degree because they haven't had a long enough period of time to affect the genome of our dogs. But it's what went on in the more recent past, say over the last 5,000 to 10,000 years during the period of major domestication or evolution of our dogs from the wolf, and then going back even further and looking what those ancestors ate. And very simply, I discovered some time ago that if we look into that, basically it's an animal's carcass that the dog used to eat. However, there are some little tweaks to that, because the dog evolved not just as a hunter and a carnivore or an obligate carnivore like the cat, but the dog evolved as a scavenger, very much so over the last 10,000 years, as it scavenged the results of human hunting exploits and human food. And as a scavenger, it ate lots of bones. Now, so putting it very simply, the dog is a a hunter, a carnivore, to some degree an omnivore, because it eats the gut contents of its prey when things are tough, particularly, but also when it has the feels internally the need to eat that. And it's a scavenger. So as a scavenger, it eats lots of rotten and revolting foods that we don't necessarily find attractive. But we'll come back to that, because that's a very important part of the dog's diet. It's also an important part of our diet. So, and it eats lots of bones because it's a scavenger, and it eats the whole animal. So from that, we can gauge that the dog is a little bit different to the cat in that it eats more bones and it eats more of this rotten and revolting or fermented food, if you like. And but apart from that, what do we feed? Well, we feed organ meat, we feed muscle meat, we feed bones, and we feed something to represent that fermented food. And it also eats vegetables, and we can feed that as well. Not absolutely essential, but that's all part of what we need to learn if we're going to feed raw. Basically a whole animal, but looking at this idea that the dog is more of a scavenger and making those little tweaks, and also believing that our dog can actually eat raw. That's very important. The dog, a lot of people can't believe that because they're so used to seeing them eating cooked food and processed food and grain-based food that they can't believe they should eat raw food based on animal products. And that is a crazy concept if you think about it, if you think about the biology of the dog and where the dog has come from. It's evolved from the wolf. So that's the simple background. That's what we should be feeding our dogs. We certainly shouldn't be feeding them the masses of carbohydrates, which go straight to sugar in the bloodstream, that we currently feed.
Especially when you look to the wild, we live in kind of a unique part of America up in the mountains of Colorado with a heck of a lot of coyotes. We even have some wolves out there. We have mountain lions. And so you can see spines and rib cages and all of that just lying in the sand or out in the forest. And, you know, once every few weeks or so, our dog goes out there and comes back with something, whether it's a leg or, you know, a piece of the ribs or a little bit of marrow bone, whatever it is. And to some extent, we could prevent it from happening, but it's I have never seen that dog happier than when she's come back with a big leg from a mule deer or something like that.
And that's why, Abel, I called my first book, Give Your Dog a Bone.
Yes, exactly. And Give Your Dog a Bone is a fantastic book and a wonderful approach. I think it was in that book you talk about how universal truths don't change. Sometimes, you know, the fancy of the market or what social media is talking about or whatever is, you know, relevant in culture can seem to change things, but the universal truths do not change. And a dog chewing on a bone is one of those universal truths, isn't it?
Absolutely. So when they've dragged that leg back from out in the wild, all rotten and stinking, that's nature at work. That's the dog following the instincts that have evolved over millions of years. And that's what we need to try and duplicate, not necessarily with stuff that's horrible in our apartments where it's, we have to find a way of duplicating that. And I'll talk about that because quite recently I had a revelation when I met a raw feeder who I'd spoken to 20 years ago and he followed that advice and he started a company on fermented foods. And wow, I was very excited when I heard about that. But that's just, and that's a part of the diet. It try and duplicates that rotten and revolting stuff to some degree. And that's very important. Because we're now learning that the microbiome, the gut of the dog, really rules to a large degree. And of course, why wouldn't it? It's where the food comes through the dog and out the other end as poop. It's where the dog actually starts with that whole nutritional thing. But anyway, this is all part of the story.
And the fermentation piece is one that many humans have lost sight of, especially in recent years. Of course, there's kombucha, there's some fermented meats, there's sauerkraut and things like that. And some people are very into it. But generally speaking, it seems that many are losing sight of it. And most of us probably haven't even considered it for pets. So why is the fermentation so important to what's going on in their digestive system and their nutritional needs?
Well, I've talked about to some degree that dogs like to eat rotten and revolting food. Actually, I've talked about it a lot. They'll dig up bones. They'll drag in rotting legs off something out in the wild that some other dog is, or a wolf or a coyote or something has pulled down. They will hunt out and find feces from herbivores particularly. So all this fermented food that they just absolutely love. And, of course, they bury their bones and dig them up all rotten and stinking. So they are looking instinctively for bacterial activity on their food. And what does bacterial activity do? Well, it makes things a lot more digestible, but it produces new compounds. And those new compounds are very important to their health. And, in fact, when I first started this whole dietary regime, I thought to myself, how do we get this into them? Well, one way was to feed tripe, green tripe. Now, in Australia particularly, green tripe, which contains the microorganisms from the rumen of a ruminant, the green tripe, we are not allowed to feed it. It's verboten by the authorities. So we couldn't do that. And I knew, speaking to some English people, particularly from the Second World War, that's how their dogs survived. That's all they ate, the ruminal contents. And they thrived far better than dogs today. And this was reported to me. This was a couple of people. I remember one particularly. He was in fact, a German, had migrated to England. This was the Second World War, so, there's a bit of irony here. And he had Rottweilers, of course, being a German, and these Rottweilers absolutely thrived on a vegetarian diet of rumen contents. So I knew that this was important, but we couldn't do the rumen thing. We tried the sauerkraut and so on, and that dog said, not that keen on it. What I did was throw in yogurt and kefir and that sort of thing and tried to make it up that way. And then some people said, well, my dog has a dairy allergy, oh dear, so we couldn't do it that way. When I met Rob, he was fermenting vegetables and he wanted to make a business out of it. He said, but I need a bit of help and expertise. So he asked me to join him. So we are now producing fermented vegetables and we're obviously looking at those vegetables as a brilliant, there you go. Yes. Rob did send you a sample, didn't he?
He did, and we really appreciate it. And I'll tell you what, compared to all the stinky stuff you're talking about, one of the things that surprised us the most was how good this smells.
Yeah.
It reminds us of those fancy, you can only get it at juice bars here in the States, dehydrated raw vegan crackers or something that is really hard to get in super concentrated nutrition, but this smells really good and our dog so far loves it.
Well, if we can restore the microbiome of our dogs, we're going to restore health. And this was the missing piece for me. And when Rob said, let's do this, or would you help me, I was in. I said, yep, let's do it. And one of the reasons too was because even the raw food manufacturers for pets in America particularly, they have to do this high-pressure pasteurization or even advised to gently cook it, all that stuff. They're actually killing the microbiome. I said, well, this even for these dogs, it's a good thing to add it back in. But even if they haven't done that, it's still a great thing because you're adding in a wonderful part of what the dog would naturally eat, kind of the fermented vegetable gut contents of a herbivore. That's what we're trying to mimic to a large degree, but using whatever vegetables are available now. And it's great because you don't need a lot of it. And if you feed it on a pretty regular basis, and I'd also recommend taking a week or two off and then going back to it, because that's important too with nutrition. But do feed it regularly and you're going to see such a change to your dog's microbiome. And we now know that even mental health, all aspects of health are related to the microbiome. They've even taken some poop, and they've done this with mice, but we believe it's applicable to all species, from fat mice and put it into lean mice, naturally lean mice. They've become fat, and they've done the reverse. They've taken the poop from lean mice, put them into fat mice, and the fat mice have lost weight. So there's a heck of a lot going on with our microbiome and bacteria that we don't really understand. Anyway, when Rob told me about this, I knew that because my dogs were doing brilliantly without this, but when we added this back in, fermented foods, we even see a better change in their life. And we can also add it to dogs who are on dry food and all the terrible foods. And I also think that when people start thinking about the diet by adding in something as simple as this, hey, can we go a bit further? Can we go a bit further? And I'll tell you one other thing that happens, and this happens all the time in my practice. Well, it did. I've now stopped practicing and now concentrating on writing and talking to folk like yourself. But people would say, hey, if this works for my dog, could it possibly work for me? And instead of saying, no, duh, I said, yes. I mean, you want to say that because it's so obvious, but you say you encourage them, of course, and that's what I've been doing. It's been the hidden agenda for my work that when people start, and this is part of our dogs being our best friend, because they're displaying to us when we change their diet and their health improves so dramatically, they're telling us, hey, you could do this too. So, yeah, that's the hidden agenda. So working on all species, from cats, dogs, to humans, as a vet should.
And it's true. One of the most startling aspects of changing the dietary approach is how it changes their behavior. You can see them become more playful or have more energy. And we don't want to think that that's necessarily true for humans, especially that if you go slam a pizza or something like that, you'll have a negative effect on your energy or on your health. But you can certainly see, I remember just a few months ago, we had Dr. William Davis on the show who talked about different strains of probiotics, and roid rye in particular can help reverse some of that, the morbid obesity that you see in some of those mouse and rat studies, I think it was, and transplanting one to the other and changing the microbiome. We've been experimenting with different strains of roid rye over the past few months and have seen some remarkable changes in the way that our dog, who's now, coming up on 11 years old, which is getting older for Labrador, especially the bigger breeds, becoming more playful, jumping up into the truck again and all sorts of other things. It's wonderful to see those changes. And I would hope that people, pet owners, would start to realize that, yes, this could work for humans too, or at least something that's biologically appropriate. So how do humans, or should humans, eat differently from a dog, for example?
Oh, well, not that much different, really. We're two very similar species. And in fact, some studies have shown that our microbiome corresponds more than any other two species. So we're pretty
interesting.
Well, I guess all the apes, of which we are one, they obviously have a very close microbiome. But we and the dog, we've co-evolved over many, well, it actually may be up to 100,000, even possibly longer, but that's the whole story of the evolution of the dog and man. We've co-evolved. So it's not surprising that we have a very similar microbiome. But the difference is more that the dog is able, being a scavenger, is more capable of eating something like a food rich in salmonella or E. coli, which we possibly would become quite sick from eating. And in fact, that's a major difference. The acid content of the dog's stomach is probably a little bit stronger and able to deal with that. Also, their immune system is more tuned to eat these bacterial species. And I think we have to also understand there, and just on diverging slightly from that question, how we differ, but the immunity or our immune system and our dog's immune system, it's not really a fight with the species that surround us in our environment. It's not a fight with bacteria. It's learning to live with and in harmony, because they are part of us. They are a very important part of us. So our immune system is there not to so much defend us as we think, but to help us live in harmony with the other species in our environment, because they are where we came from and they are an essential part of our being. And it's only when something, one of those species becomes overcrowded, so say A. salmonella or E. coli, that we start to see sickness, a pathology. We actually require them. And that actually makes me a bit sad when we have a high pressure pasteurization and all that stuff actually destroying every organism in there, when in fact They are there for our dog to learn how to live with, and that includes so-called pathogens. But anyway, the difference between us and them is not real great. I mean, there are certain things like chocolate, which we can eat in large amounts. The dog should not eat because that can actually be toxic. Onions is another thing. And in fact, I've written a whole book on that one, but which I haven't actually published yet, would you believe? But in essence, we are pretty much the same. We are both omnivores with a carnivorous background. The dog is an omnivore, but closer to being a carnivore than humans. And I've actually got I should have that with me at all times when I'm doing these talks. What I call the carnivore, well, it's actually it's a spectrum of species. So at one end we have the it's a continuum. We have all the cats. At the other end we have all the herbivores, and in between, right in the center, we find things like chickens and pigs. Then moving closer to the dog and the cat at one end, we have humans, and then moving even closer to the cat, we have the dog. And so everybody sits somewhere on this continuum between pure herbivores and pure carnivores, but even the pure herbivores will eat some animal matter, and the pure carnivores will eat vegetable matter. So it really is, that's where we all sit on this continuum. And people like to label animals, like they label the, if we look at the panda, for example, it's labeled as a carnivore. It's a carnivore, but of course it's a vegetarian. It's bamboo shoots and that sort of thing. So really we're not that different. We just have to understand those few little differences and then go for it. But what we all share in common is that we should eat raw whole foods as less cooked as we can. Now, we humans, we just love our cooked food, and there's nothing better than being a good chef, is there, and creating all those wonderful foods. But if we base our life on sugar and carbohydrates, that life, we may be able to prolong it with modern medicine, but the last part of it is going to be filled with disease. We have to mimic what our ancestors ate over evolutionary time. And I can't get away from that. In fact, the other thing, in case I miss out on saying this, our dogs and cats, as they evolved, and even going back, say, 200 years, there was no Excel spreadsheet which told them they had to have so much magnesium, so much iron, so much calcium, so much phosphorus. You see, we think of feeding our dogs today, unfortunately, as feeding them nutrients. No, we feed them food. And if we feed whole foods that they evolved eating, they will pick from that food what they require. And the other thing that I'm going to say at this point, and it's important, every meal does not have to be complete and balanced. That's a commercial constraint, because then a commercial production of dog food has to be that way. But if you're feeding real food, you don't have to worry about it. Sure, get the balance over a period of time, that's fine. That's the way we feed ourselves, or we should feed ourselves. And in fact, this brings me to another very important aspect of feeding the dog, which is fasting. And we now know that intermittent fasting for humans is good. It's also great for dogs. And if we shorten that interval of eating for our dog during a shorter period within each 24 hours, we're actually giving our dog a bit of that. Now, I think from what I can see now, that because the dogs in the wild didn't eat a complete and balanced meal at a complete and balanced diet at every meal, that's how they evolved. So the question now comes up, by supplying them a complete and balanced diet at every meal, are we in fact doing something to destroy their health? Is it in fact, because they have evolved eating a particular way, shouldn't we try to mimic that as well? Because that's the whole thing about my philosophy. Well, what I believe is the correct philosophy, feeding how evolution has evolved or has brought our dog into being. If we follow the principles we find there, those are going to be the principles that keep our dog going for the longest. And we certainly know about fasting now. But I think this this concept, and we have so many people out there who are worried that if they miss out on one nutrient in their dog's diet at dinner, the dog is going to go into some mortal spin and collapse and die before their very eyes. And that is such absolute rubbish. It's not the way that our dogs are designed. It's not the way ourselves are designed. Anyway, I'm just throwing that in for what it wasn't worth. We are all very similar, and there's just a few little tweaks that we need to do between the dog's diet and our own. And some of those are pretty obvious. Like, we definitely don't go out and eat poop. A dog could, and he'll do well. Having said that, the Eskimos do. They eat reindeer poop. It's part of their fiber. That's when they're eating their traditional diet. So
I did not know
there's
that.
There's lots of contradictions. Yes.
And so that would be for the probiotics from the herbivore.
And the fiber for their bowel.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so the prebiotics.
Probiotics and... Prebiotics, exactly right. Yes, exactly right. So when we follow these, I mean, this was something that struck me, that all the very early on, because I was looking at human diets and dog diets as I learnt about real nutrition, as opposed to the nutrition I'd been taught, both as an agricultural science undergraduate and a veterinary undergraduate. I studied the diets of people who were living their primitive lifestyle. One of the most important things I noticed was they were all different.
Yes.
You can't find the pygmies, the little people in the African, wherever they are in Africa, eating the same diet as the Eskimos or the Inuits. But they had characteristics in common. They were all whole and mostly raw, and they weren't messed around with by humans to any great degree. And there was a huge wide variety of what they ate. And they didn't mess with their food. And what they did eat was large amounts of either sugar or starchy grains, because it just wasn't available.
I would love to circle back on what you said before about pathogens and how we kind of have to live with them. So it's really interesting, because out here in the wild, people are really worried about drinking from the water. And dogs in particular, there are some dogs who never go and drink out of the streams because of giardia and other waterborne illness that could be waiting for them there. Then there are other dogs.
Perhaps.
Yeah, but then there are other dogs and coyotes and everything else that's what they do every morning and every afternoon. They're over there, they're drinking out of that water, and they seem totally fine. So what is that dilemma there? Could you help explain both sides of that and how that plays out?
Well, I think we do have to be careful. I mean, just at the moment in where I live in Sydney, we've had so much rain and we've got water everywhere. A lot of it is stagnating. And because of the rain, we've had a buildup of rats and mice. There's been insects that they can eat, and they always seem to thrive under these wet circumstances. And there is a chance that some of them will carry this thing called leptospirosis. Now, if the dog actually gets leptospirosis, they become exceedingly sick. So we try to discourage our dogs from drinking that kind of water around us here. But what we're talking about here is a real buildup within an urban society of huge populations of rats and mice, and it's concentrating. Out in the wilds, you don't have that concentration. And if they're drinking from streams that are flowing and passing through sand and rapidly flowing, that water is pretty damn good. Now, not only that, more importantly, because these animals are eating their natural diet, their immune system has learned to live with these pathogens. So we have to look at the balance now between what's happening in an urban society that isn't in line with the way they evolved, and that difference out in the wild. And so, but we also have to understand that our dogs will be far more resilient to bacteria and pathogens and more able to live with them if they're living with a diet that mimics or is very close to what they evolved to eat. So we have to do these things intelligently, and if we can see a situation where there is danger, remove our dogs from it. But as best we can, try and make them live with bacteria. And I guess that's one of the reasons I was so excited when Rob said to me, hey, I'm forming this company making fermented food. I thought, yes, that's another thing that is going to help our dogs live better with their environmental bacteria. And that's the exciting part. So have to be intelligent, but that intelligence must include an understanding of where our dogs came from and how diet is the most important aspect of health, and we must mimic that evolutionary diet and everything about it as closely as possible. And that includes our dogs didn't evolve with all these chemicals we've produced today, and they live very close to the floor, and we put down lots of chemicals in our houses. The more we can eliminate those chemicals from our houses, the more we can protect our dogs living with us so closely from the dangers of those toxins, because this is where that most dreaded disease, cancer, starts to arise. And that's another huge story between diet and sickness and pathology and degenerative disease in general.
So if a dog is not eating its biologically appropriate diet, if it's eating grain-based kibble, then maybe it can't get away with drinking the bacterial load from the stream, or it might become overwhelmed by worms after eating that deer leg or something like that. Yet the dogs that have a healthy immune system and a microbiome that's functioning appropriately can actually process through these biological agents that are a little, you know, a little gnarly, right?
That's right. Better able to deal and live in harmony with those agents. That's correct. And that's the thing we have to keep in mind. We don't deliberately put our dog in harm's way, but we can be super confident that our dogs fed properly on a raw whole food diet are better able to deal with those things.
So another thing about, let's talk about dogs first. When we give our dog a bone, which we've been doing pretty much regularly, as regularly as we can, really, over the course of her entire life, it's not just food. It's a whole thing for her, right? It's a whole experience. It's entertainment, it's exercise, and it's a type of entertainment and exercise that we could never give her as humans, right? A dog with a bone. So what's going on there for them that's so special?
There's a lot of things happening here. Because the dog evolved as a scavenger, it's evolved eating bones. And it actually gets, well, let's go back to the nutrition. It gets an enormous amount of nutrition from a raw meaty bone from a young animal. And I observed this in my clients' pets. Very early on, the dogs that ate lots of bones from the butchers, and they're generally from young animals, and they actually consumed the whole bones. These are the dogs that had the greatest health and had the greatest longevity and had the greatest health span in their life. And I said, well, why is this so? You know, you have to ask why when you make an observation, and you can only then start to provide hypotheses and theories as to why it's so. I hypothesized, and I still live by this hypothesis, for first of all, that it's the perfect source of calcium and phosphorus in a balanced format for the dog. Everybody tries to get that right, and you'll tear your hair out trying to get it right using processed pet foods, and that's what our manufacturers do. They tear their hair out trying to get that right, and they use all sorts of calculations, whatever. And so that was number one. That's very good. Then I looked at it. Well, okay, it's a great source of a raw meaty bone is a great source of protein of the right type with all the essential amino acids. The marrow contains brilliant fats, particularly the marrow of long bones, because those long bones are actually living out in the cold. So those long bones have to have lots of polyunsaturates in them to deal with the cold. Otherwise, they would just simply go hard. So, and dog requires polyunsaturates. Also got all the iron-forming elements, so the blood-forming elements. So, you know, this is fantastic nutrition. And when you start to look at it, a raw meaty bone is almost a complete and balanced diet, if you will, for a dog. So, but it goes beyond that. It's exercise, it's eating exercise, and mum will actually bring back that for young puppies, and they'll start out by ripping and tearing at that bone as young pups, and they're getting isometric exercise. And They're also becoming accustomed to saying, this is food. And the other thing that's happening is they've got dental health going on, because as they rip and tear, they're massaging their gums, they're helping their teeth to erupt. All these wonderful things are happening. Now, of course, the bone is going to be covered in bacteria. So they're getting their microbiome massaged, if you will, or filled with the right sort of bacteria. And this is why up here, the dog absolutely loves instinctively to eat raw meaty bones. And if you try and take it off a dog, well, our dogs are trained that we can take it off them, but a dog that is untrained, and particularly if you give this a bone to a dog that's never had one before, he will tell you, and he or she will tell you in no uncertain terms, hey, don't you try to take this off me. You've at last woken up that this is what I actually need. But of course, there's more. And I knew that when I started advocating raw meaty bones, because I could observe how important they were, and I realized the dog was a scavenger and with a genetic and evolutionary background, I said, we're going to find out more about this. Now, one of the things, and we have, and I believe there's still more to be discovered about all of this, one of the things I discovered when I was researching cancer is that the cartilage at the end of the big bones, any cartilage on a bone, is absolutely vital to the health of the dog. One, for its joints, so the glycosaminoglycans in that, or the GAGs, they're very essential for the joint health of that growing puppy, for the adult dog, and so on. But secondly, they're also a cancer preventative. And because cartilage has this wonderful anti-angiogenic effect, that is, it stops the growth of blood vessels within cancers. And dogs, and so I often wondered why these bone-eating dogs rarely developed cancers. If they did, they developed them later in life and they were less aggressive. And in fact, we now know that cancer is something that can sit in all our bodies, but if we're eating the right sort of diet, it actually inhibits those cancers from growing. So we have all these micro cancers just waiting there to spring up. If we're on a high sugar diet, we're going to feed those, they're going to go for it. And the diet of today helps the cancers to grow blood vessels within the cancer. And so it can get nutrients to itself and it can grow. It requires blood vessels to grow. So just this simple bone, this humble bone with its cartilage on it, was also helping to prevent cancer and helping the joints and probably doing a whole lot more. Because our biological systems are these cybernetic systems of feedback loops and things that every gene, for example, produces lots of different proteins, so that when you deal with a gene, you might knock it out with a drug. Genes have what they call pleiotropic effects. That is, they affect many different things, not just the thing that you think you know about. And of course, so this results in side effects. That's one of the reasons why drugs produce side effects. But when you feed natural foods, they're the way the dog has evolved, with all these mechanisms and these counterbalancing effects that work to produce harmony, we call a homeostasis, within the body. And again, that's just, if you follow evolutionary norms, that is, you feed what the dog evolved to eat, suddenly all that is happening, but you don't have to worry about that because it's producing health without you really understanding why. And we probably never will fully understand it with our scientific endeavors, because science isn't that clever yet.
Nature is certainly more clever than science, it seems, these days. So for a raw meaty bone, it's like, how does a human eat that? Well, you could throw it into a pot of water and simmer it for a long time, and you all of a sudden are eating pretty much all of that, right?
Yeah, we tend not to eat ourselves raw meaty bones. I guess as humans, we have been cooking bones and meat for a long period of time, maybe 100,000 years. So maybe we have evolved dealing with cooked food more than the dog has evolved, but not cooked grains. We've only done that over the last 10,000 years. But cooked meat, yes, we have been eating that for a long period of time. And so, again, for humans, we have to think, how did we evolve? And if we can follow our evolutionary norms, and people call it the Paleolithic diet, and now it's become ketogenic diet. And let me add that the ketogenic state is physiological and natural and I guess most of your people who follow you understand what ketosis is and how you get there. But if you think about it, we get there by mostly by eliminating carbs or by eliminating food. Because if we go into a fasting mode or starvation, whichever way you want to put it, our body starts to burn fat and produces ketones. Now, as humans as hunter-gatherers for hundreds of thousands of years, dogs the same, had periods when they didn't eat. And, of course, they went into ketosis. So intermittent ketosis, and that includes its effect on the brain, is absolutely normal for us. We are not doing something abnormal. It is what we evolved to require. And so people who intermittently fast, intermittently go on a high, really carnivorous diet with high fat and lowish protein, and, of course, no carbs, they're doing what mankind has done for millions of years, and our dogs are the same. So I think I've brought it up, the whole ketosis thing, in my latest book, which is Pointing the Bone at Cancer. And this is where I'm trying to push the idea that we have to think of cancer as a metabolic disease more than a genetic disease, and deal with it metabolically. And that's part of the using ketosis as an enemy of cancer and the friend of humans, because cancers, for the most part, and there are some cancers that don't follow these rules and they have their own metabolism, but cancers mostly metabolize or use sugar for their energy. If we can cut the sugar out, then we can starve the cancers, and that's just so important. And then replace the energy for the patient with ketones, and it's perfectly natural and normal. But that's a whole story.
Yeah, but sugar starts craving itself, right? The bugs that you have, the bad bugs, start saying, all right, it's 6 p.m. Let's get to this. Or, you know, for some people, all day, every 15 minutes, whatever it is. Yet, if you start to dial that down and you re-engage your natural way of eating, like you said, the real whole foods, in the true sense of the word, then all of a sudden it's not the bad bugs that are taking over anymore. You start to have more natural cravings. And like the young pup that learned how, oh, this is food. The same thing can happen with humans when they have a good solid bone broth, or they realize what true hunger is after fasting, and then eat a big old steak and notice the difference between how that feels compared to eating a big old salad or a pizza or whatever it is, because you'll notice a difference.
Well, if you're having a salad, whack plenty of olive oil on it. I mean, you've got to eat the fat with the food.
Yes.
And suddenly that fat satiates you. It takes away the hunger. People who just eat lean meat, they become very hungry very quickly, because the old gluconeogenesis, the production of sugar from protein, kicks in, because we need that sugar. For example, our blood cells require sugar. And even our brain, when we're in ketosis, has a 20% requirement for sugar. But we just need enough protein within our diet. We actually need more fat. And it's terrible. We've become so afraid of fat, and we think saturated fat is bad. It's incredible how industry and misapplied science has absolutely destroyed the health of our dogs, cats, and this nation. It's incredible, the whole Western world.
And you've talked in your work before about some of the reasons for that, that the health authorities who are coming up with the nutritional recommendations are corporate industry pet food owning ponds. You know, that's kind of a problem. And the same can be argued might be true with human nutrition as well when you talk about that. But let's dig into another little point as well, where you talked about how we might be doing ourselves or our pets a disservice by trying to hit 100% of those nutritional requirements every single day. That's not the way that nature works at all. That's not the way that the seasons, the cycles of nature work. That's not the way that our bodies, I would think, would naturally work either.
It's not the way our bodies work. And we don't have any actual science beyond the observation that that's the way evolution worked. But I believe we're going to discover that this is the way we should be feeding ourselves. And in fact, it is the way we feed ourselves. Well, most of us, we never attempt to make each meal complete and balanced. We know what we should eat and we follow it. And not only that, once you start eating real food, then your natural instincts start to crave what you want and what you actually, sorry, what you need. So what you want becomes actually what you need when you're eating real food and you're following these evolutionary norms. And your body says, okay, now I do need a bit more calcium. So we're going to start looking for foods that require that or whatever. I mean, I just throw in calcium, but we will look naturally to those foods. And so we might say, oh, today I could really eat a beautiful piece of salmon. So your body says, yep, I want those omega-3s that are in the salmon and that those particular amino acids that predominate within fish. You know, if we're following the real food paradigm, that's the way it works. Or I really don't feel like a salad today. I just want that juicy steak with lots of fat and maybe a little bit of sour cream. So, wow, let's get stuck into that, you know, and your body does the same. So, unfortunately, a lot of people with their dogs don't have the time to do that. So they end up feeding, I guess, a complete and balanced diet from a raw pet food producer. And, you know, we can't get around that. But if you have the time to understand the different foods and the wide variety of foods your dog can eat, and we try to put that in the book, like Give Your Dog a Bone, then you can do that for your dog too. But it does take a little bit of extra effort.
It's hilarious. I'll share just a quick story. I used to walk our dog in Texas, and we would do the same little walk pretty much every day through the local park. And this, I only saw this happen one time. I was walking with my wife and my dog, and there was this like small tree or a shrub or a bush. I didn't really recognize it. And it had these little nuts or fruits or something that I definitely didn't recognize. And she just, our dog went completely nuts and started just going after all of these little things, probably eating, you know, 50 or 80 or 100 of these little things, just going as for 5 or 10 minutes, just having the time of her life and eating this unrecognizable seed or nut or fruit or veg or something. It just seemed like an ornamental plant or whatever. And I think that's a pretty good example. That never happened again. You know, like I only saw that one time. And that is the complete opposite of the way that most of us feed ourselves and our pets, where it's the same thing every single day and the same little amounts or the same spectrum of amounts. Whereas the way that nature works is sometimes great abundance of steak and other times great abundance of squash or some strange small shrub that you have to eat to survive or that your body really cries out for sometimes. But how do you help people embrace that way of thinking about nutrition with their animals or with their own habits?
Local availability, seasonal availability. That's really the key to that. It's, yeah, local and seasonal. And because that's, if they're being produced, the food's being produced in that area and in that particular season, that's the best food you can feed. And but also a wide variety. But also, when you go for the wide variety, it's appropriate. I was going to say biologically appropriate. It's species appropriate. It's appropriate for that species, and which is pretty good for our dogs because they are carnivores, omnivores, scavengers. So there's a lot to choose from. You just have to have that mindset, and that's what. And what I teach is principles, rather than recipes. And I know that's difficult for some people. They just want recipes. They want to be told, this is what you must do. But if I can get into people's heads, it's principles, so that you look out at the foods and you have an understanding, that is a dog-appropriate food. That is not. That cooked grain mush, that cereal that you feed your kids in the morning, high in sugar, that's not dog-appropriate. It's not what they evolved eating. You know, there wasn't a single dog in history that went hunting a field of wheat. And not too many of them, as I understand it, had microwaves back in the day or stoves. I'm talking about our dogs. So, you know, you just have to think logically, and what did our dogs eat? And that's the simple key, principles. And that's what I want people to learn. And the more you can understand that, the more then you become confident of feeding your dog properly on a wide variety of foods. Kind of keep them healthy. And translate that to your kids if you're young and you've got kids growing up. And in Give Your Dog a Bone, I actually wrote about the young housewife who really did give a great deal of thought to the dog She was just raising kids, and there was a dog in the backyard, and she threw the scraps and some butcher's bones. The dog grew beautifully. And I compared that with a young couple who tried to do the very best by their dog and followed all the nutritional advice from their vet and had enormous problems. But anyway, that was back in the day. Today, our vet will just say feed processed pet food. The dog will grow up not too bad on that, but you're setting the dog up for a lifetime of degenerative disease because, yes, it's balanced. It's got enough nutrients to make that young pup grow okay, mostly, not always. But you are setting the dog up for a lifetime of disease. Perfect business model, by the way, for vets. If you can recommend the food that produces the patients, that brings them back to you, but the two things are never correlated. There's no connection made between the food you recommend and the disease it's producing. And then you reap the benefits of selling the food and getting the patients in and the owners paying for, or the pet parents paying for all those diagnostics and treatments. What a business model. Most vets don't understand that that's what they're doing. So if they did, I think they would be horrified. But it's all part of their training now, and it's carried out by the pet food companies. Their training in nutrition. How sad is that?
Well, you know, someone kind of reframed it when they told me these doctors and these veterinarians are paid not to know. And I'm like, oh, that makes a lot more sense. It's not a lack of education as much as they're paid not to know this stuff. And sometimes that seems to be at work as well. That's why we need your work, Dr. Billinghurst. And I really appreciate you taking the time with us here today. So before we go, can you please tell folks where they can find your books, your work, and what you're working on next?
Okay, two very simple websites they need to go to. Dr. Ian Billinghurst.com and get my books there, and gussiesgut.com for Gussie's Gut. They can get a sample of that wonderful product, and I say it's wonderful because I help Rob to produce it, and as you've experienced, dogs love it, and we know it's going to do some good out there. So get your free sample, I say, and give this a go, and you won't regret it. But go to my website, drnbillinghurst.com, and get hold of the books and just learn the simple principles of feeding your dog properly. It is so simple. You don't need an Excel spreadsheet.
I love it. Dr. Billinghurst, thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you, Abel. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you for having me on your show. I appreciate it.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate nut cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening, and have a great week.